And up in the, going back to John's last night, I guess the, in some ways the popular understanding of that word, where we think of materialism in some ways as a continuation of a consumerist culture, if you like, and sustainable materialism being how can we sort of continue consuming material goods but doing it in a sustainable way. So I'm sort of going to address that through one specific approach to that issue, and that is the introduction of various certification schemes for sustainability and what the implications of those are. This draws on a research program of mine, I guess, over the last 8 or 9 years, which has been looking into introduction of certification schemes into the tropical commodity sector in Southeast Asia as well as in South Asia. So the idea was to bring together, I guess, some of the key findings of that program over the period and sort of to start thinking about, I guess, what the future might be for certification, because I believe that it's hit a bit of a, if not a brick wall, it's certainly hitting a lot of obstacles now, and a lot of people within the industry, within the different movements, are asking questions about how we move forward in terms of sustainable supply chains. So I guess the first point I wanted to make, I'll be talking today mostly about the coffee and cocoa commodities, because that's coffee in particular has probably had one of the longer periods of having its product certified in various ways, going back a couple of decades now, and it's also consumes a larger part of the total coffee market than a number of other commodities. So I think there's a number of lessons that we can learn from that particular case study. And so, first of all, when I talk about certification, just so I guess we're clear, I'm talking about these sorts of third-party schemes, whether it's Rainforest Alliance is an increasingly popular scheme, UTZ certified, the top there is a Fair Trade logo, and I've put there organic because in many ways these schemes evolved from earlier systems of organic production and certification. And it's also this use of normally attaching these marks, whether it's Rainforest Alliance, attaching them to the final consumer product so that consumers can make an ethical choice about the products they're consuming, and that would there, so we would hope, would have positive ramifications along the supply chain to the production systems. So in terms of where these systems came from, I think there's a few points I'd like to make which helps us to understand a bit more of a few of the contradictions that are appearing now in terms of how these schemes are being rolled out. In terms of coffee, as I said, the certification schemes very much evolved from organic coffee. It's been said the first major exports of organic coffee were in the early 1980s. And then by the end of the 1980s, there was the first fair trade coffee was launched through the Max Havala organised that foundation in the Netherlands. And these were two distinct movements. One was, of course, to address issues of poverty in the global south, and the other one was part of a much more broad-ranging movement, if you like, for alternative production systems and alternative forms of consumption through the organics. Alongside that, there was particularly in the US coffee market in particular, there are a lot of concerns over the production systems in Central America where the US is sourcing a lot of their coffee from, and how changing production systems, in particular the removal of shade trees, was affecting habitat for various songbirds and other migratory bird species going into the US. And so that loss of habitat was perceived to be a direct problem in North America. And so alongside fair trade, alongside organics, we saw the emergence of Smithsonian bird-friendly coffee, for example, which was sort of certifying farms as maintaining particular forms of habitat. So therefore, you could make an ethical choice about consuming coffee that would maintain habitat in Central America. And then Rainforest Alliance, juxtaposed, as I say, sort of emerged alongside that. I don't really want to go through the details here, but I guess the point I'm making there is that there's been incredible growth within the mainstream coffee and cocoa sectors in particular in embracing these forms of third-party certification, and it's certainly evolved well beyond being an alternative market arrangement or alternative trade networks to be very much mainstream. We see Nestle, Sara Lee, Mars, McDonald's in Australia, all these sort of very mainstream food and beverage companies who are now offering, often it's a range within, it's a particular product within their range that's going to be certified, but a lot of the larger companies as well have made commitments such as Mars by 2020 that all their global cocoa suppliers will be sustainably certified. So from the corporate world, there's been an embrace of these schemes as being a solution, but as I'll go through, a solution, I guess, to what becomes a question. Is it a solution to their own supply problems? Is it a solution to their brand ability to manage their own brand, or is it a solution to sort of overcoming some of the underlying environmental and social problems attached with these industries? So the point being, there's been enormous growth and enormous embrace. So for these reasons, I think that, again, the coffee sector gives us a whole bunch of insights into what it might mean, or the potential for rolling this out across various other products and commodities. Again, it's just showing Kraft as an example there. This is their increases since 2004 of their purchases of Rainforest Alliance certified coffee. And again, making claims that by 2015, all of their European coffee brands will be sustainably certified. Okay, so what I wanted to do now, looking at that as the background, that's what's happening within the industries, is to, I guess, reflect a little bit on why there's been such broad uptake of these schemes. And in the, I guess, in the cocoa industry, certainly the big driver has been allegations or the uncovering of various labour abuses in West Africa, in Côte d'Ivoire in particular, but also in Ghana, where a lot of the cocoa being produced there is being produced under exploitative labour conditions, child labour, and also the use of slave labour. So the companies themselves have seen these forms of certification, these systems of certification, as ways of being able to distance their products from these sorts of labour abuses. So in that way, it's quite defensive in the cocoa industry. In the coffee industry, again, there was in around 2000-2001, coffee prices were at some of their lowest prices in history, for that matter. And because of that, there was a lot of campaigns such by Oxfam and others about the global coffee crisis, and therefore the solution to that was promoted to being through fair trade coffee. So again, the large coffee companies, Starbucks in particular, was very concerned over its brand, over its reputation, and images of sort of Starbucks stores being trashed at the Seattle riots and WTO, you know, were very much a major concern for these companies. And I think Eric talked yesterday about this movement away from brands as being the most important to some sort of trust mark. And I think these sorts of schemes have been embraced by the companies as an external trust mark, the way they can sort of regain the trust of consumers. We see again in the palm oil industry in Southeast Asia, as that the allegations that certain companies are sourcing their products from large-scale plantations that have caused deforestation. Again, they need to be able to distance themselves from that. So I guess the argument I'm putting forward here is that essentially it's a matter of defensive brand management. Is that how can these brands, which are now, because of all the symbolic value tied up in corporate brands these days, they're also very susceptible. The very successful campaigns against Nestle, against Nike and the Gap, of course, with the labour abuses as well, sort of opened up these companies to these sorts of allegations and therefore produced the need to distance themselves from that. The other point I wanted to make is that top one there, global gap. That image there. So global gap emerged out of a system in the initially in the UK, but also broadly across Europe. Europe Gap, which is the European retailers' code of conduct for good agricultural practices, essentially. So a lot of the large supermarkets in the UK across Europe sort of signed up to Europe Gap, and that would allow, which in many ways was a response to food safety concerns. So in the UK, of course, various food scares, mad cow disease, dioxin contamination in Belgium, you know, broccoli and whatnot, these sorts of salmonella poisoning. So it became the onus became on the supermarkets to be able to demonstrate due diligence along their supply chain. And I just wanted to point out that it's not often recognised that these systems that have, and very much, we're very much informed by these parallel processes in relation to food safety. So global gap is a good example in point. It came essentially out of a food safety culture with a sort of HACCP style audits along the supply chain. And it was considered, well, how about we merge that with these various issues about environmental practices and social neglect at origin? And so that therefore global gap emerged, or UTS, which is a certification scheme parallel to global gap. And I guess the point I'm making here is that food safety, of course, is all about providing benefits to a consumer, just by its definition. It's about consumer health. And so these various systems, which ostensibly were put in place to address issues at origin, as it were, in sites of production, whether it's environmental problems or social problems, in the case of the global coffee crisis, were stapled together in the same system. And I would say in many ways these systems achieve the same end in providing benefits to consumers rather than producers. In this case, it's probably providing benefits to consumers in terms of their ethical consciences. We can buy a product and we can feel good about that, and therefore we're the ones that are gaining benefits from that. And there's, I think, a few questions about whether how far those benefits are actually driving up the other end of the supply chain. I would say the culture coming from the food safety culture, audit culture, is a lot. I think explains a lot about the relatively few benefits that have gone up the other end of the chain. The other, I think, important point for understanding why there's been uptake from the companies is we talk probably a bit more later on about corporate ideals of sustainability and how that's wrapped up in corporate social responsibility. But I find very much talking to the large beverage companies, when they talk about sustainability, essentially it's sustainability of supplies. Is that Mars, for example, is a big company, but it's very much focused on making chocolate. It's got a bit of pet food as well on the side, which is a strange kind of combination I always felt, but it's essentially a chocolate company. So if these guys can't keep sourcing chocolate in another 20 years' time, then they've got some serious business concerns. So within these global commodity markets, I mean, there's been a lot of concern that chocolate will be, the image there on the right, will be worth its weight in gold in 20 years, because there's various supply constraints affecting global cocoa supplies, related in part to political instability in West Africa, where the bulk of supply comes from, but also various pest and disease problems, various reliance on ongoing forest clearing for production, so that can't keep going on forever. So these companies that see, okay, maybe we can work through these certification schemes as a way of shoring up long-term supply. I think that's been the other key driver for their adoption. Okay, so now I want to switch a little bit, if you like, to the view of certification from the Global South. And this was from field work we were doing in South India, in the tea, coffee and rubber estates there. And it was a time when a number of large companies were introducing what was called the Common Code for the Coffee Community. And the planters there were up in arms about this new scheme, essentially another form of certification. And you can see here this quote, which I love, you know. Some German trade interests, with the blessing of the coffee roasting majors, developed what would be for them a largely painless, costless social and environmental initiative that would have the combined effect of blunting NGO criticism, salvaging a damaged reputation, and transferring the entire responsibility of operating this initiative to the hapless producer, while at the same time keeping their own costs and bottom lines intact. And I'd have to say, from talking to a lot of industry folks, producers in these countries, it's not a unique way of viewing these schemes. They see it all as providing benefits at the other end, and very, very few benefits for them. And I guess it comes a little bit back to maybe the way these schemes were designed anyway was about providing benefits to the consumers rather than to the producers. So that was, if you like, the first finding was this resistance against these schemes when they were ostensibly designed to actually provide benefits to them. Okay, the next issue that's emerging, and I think there's increasing recognition that this is a weakness of these schemes, is how they interact with what I call place-based environmental problems. So I guess I'm going to give three examples here, coffee-related examples, of how it's very difficult for this audit-style approach to environmental management, if you like, to be able to induce positive changes on the ground. So three examples from India, Vietnam, and Indonesia. This is a coffee farm in India. I mean, when they talk about habitat, providing habitat in the Central American coffee estates, there's bird life, for example, is a big part. When they talk about biodiversity in India, they have tigers walking through these estates. Elephants come through, bison. It's really amazing. The particular district of Kodagu in Karnataka the whole landscape there is this mix of coffee farms with a very dense shade cover in general, alongside what they call sacred groves there, which have been managed by traditional systems, alongside national parks. And this landscape mosaic provides an amazing sort of habitat for these various wildlife species. And so the key issue we have there is, okay, land use change, maybe taking out some of the shade trees will be affecting habitat, but as it is part of a landscape mosaic there, the key issue is maintaining broader ecological integrity across that landscape in a way that certification schemes are very much challenged to be able to provide benefits to. So let's go through quickly here. Indonesia, again, you could have the same system of Rainforest Alliance being rolled out in the coffee districts of Indonesia. In Indonesia, down here in southern Sumatra in Lampung, you've got a slither of a national park there. That's the dark part there of the map. Again, incredibly important for the preservation of Sumatran wildlife. And a lot of the edges of this national park are being eaten away by smallholder coffee producers. So the key issue facing this region is different to what we see in South India. It's not so much part of a landscape mosaic and the use of shade trees. As you can see, it's very a lot of clearing takes place, very little use of shade trees. And so the big issue really is this management of a protected area and how you might be able to go about ensuring that and ensuring the coffee farmers aren't eating away at it. Third example is in the central highlands of Vietnam, where the environmental problems, again, are quite distinct there. A major problem we have there is the over-extraction of groundwater. Large, large volumes of groundwater are being extracted in the central highlands and are being applied to coffee. And this has got some long-term concerns over that water supply system. It's also very intensive, very high use of agrochemicals in this environment, and that's also having impacts on the water quality. The point I'm trying to make from those three case studies there is that they all have their own place-based environmental management problems which need to be addressed. And the certification schemes come in, and I guess they have an audit-style approach, and along these floating axes of value chains that come in to regulate practices at a particular level, but there's ongoing challenges of how those same systems, those same audits, those same checklists can actually be married in some way with these very real place-based environmental problems. There's been some attempt more recently to, I think Global Gap now has Local Gap, which is about trying to marry with local environmental conditions. I think a key concern in terms of providing environmental performance is this inability to respect place-based problems. Okay, so the third, I guess, issue I wanted to highlight from my research into these certification schemes is the impact that they're having on value chain structures. And this comes a bit back to the question I was asking Eric before about prices and the costs of being able to implement these schemes. So this is just, I guess, an example of a traditional, obviously highly simplified supply chain in the Indonesian coffee industry. Before and after, once organic supply chain, organic certification was introduced, this is in the case of Aceh, what the implications have been in fact, the main actors have pretty much retained their original role. However, this farmers cooperative, producers cooperative, has been inserted within the chain. A lot of these schemes, of course, to be able to get traceability back to farm level, you need some sort of former farmer organisation. We're talking about farmers here of maybe a hectare, maybe less, very much peasant-style production. And so their ability to be able to manage, so any particular buyer will be sourcing from maybe 1,000 different farmers. So cooperatives are generally recommended as being the way that this issue of ensuring supply, of traceability, can be overcome. But unfortunately, they're sort of inserted in, and the supply chain often continues on in its own way, but there's an additional actor in there. So instead of actually cutting out the middleman, if you like, and providing more efficient supply chains, what appears to be happening in the Aceh case anyway, was that there'd be an additional actor and, in fact, additional costs. Each of these cooperatives would have a head and a treasurer and a secretary and a vice head, and all of these sort of actors would all absorb these costs in the chain. The other impact, which I'm sort of trying to show there by those lines on the right-hand one there, is increased upstream integration, particularly by the larger companies. So far, large companies now, the Nestles of the world, Starbucks, are working directly with farmers. I guess there's all sorts of debates over what the implications of that may be. In a lot of these sorts of producing countries, in Latin America, it's also very strong. The history there of skepticism towards transnational capital, and so if farmers are working directly with multinational companies, you know, there's obviously associations there politically in many of these countries with exploitation, not in many cases not unreasonably. So there's a big political debate going on around that. There is, though, another side there which says, well, direct linkages to markets provide various forms of benefits for the farmers. It's certainly an open case, but the point I'm making is that the introduction of these schemes has certainly led, I think, directly to the upstream involvement of multinationals in these rural spaces in the global south. This is a recent trip to Sulawesi, which is showing that the various Nestle, Mars, Amajaro, working at the farm level, ensuring up supply, and that's often linked to these forms of certification. So one of the big questions I have from looking at this and what we're trying to quantify now is there is a cost there, and the question becomes who bears that cost? There's various costs. There's one, the cost of actually changing the practice. An example might be removing weeds manually as opposed to using herbicides. Obviously, herbicides, if these schemes require sort of less use of herbicides, well, there's an additional labour cost in doing that manually. So there's going to be often some form of practice change that's required, and that often involves increased costs in one way or another. This is a recent survey that we've been doing, trying to ask farmers who are involved in certification schemes their opinion of any changes of expenditure. And what we can see there is the majority there are saying, well, our own labour has increased quite substantially. But we're still sort of working through this. But there seems to be a number of costs that are absorbed by the farmer to comply with these schemes. Second of all is the cost of the auditors themselves. So someone has to pay a creditable audit organisation to come to the farm. That also involves a cost. Preparing for the audit also involves a cost. I love this. This was a cooperative up in Aceh, which was some of the paperwork that's required to be able to meet these the auditors' requirements when they come through. So there's, you know, this massive desk of piles and piles of paper. That also, obviously, managing that involves a cost. Here, another cooperative in Sulawesi, a far less organised one. You sort of see this image there of this farmer who's been voted to be the head of the local cooperative, really struggling to keep up with the paperwork that's being demanded to be able to comply with these forms of certification. So there's a cost there as well. So the big question for me is who pays for that? Is it going to be the consumer and that's going to get channeled through the supply chain, or is it going to be absorbed elsewhere? So we've tried to look at this through comparing three different supply chains to the export market in Indonesia. And I guess what I wanted to highlight here was the one on the right here, and the difference between Aceh and Toraja. Both of them are coffee-producing regions, both sort of smallholder-based, both about 8 hours' drive to the nearest port. At the time of this survey, the Aceh coffee industry was very heavily certified. There was a whole lot of organic organic certified cooperatives there, Rainforest Alliance, the Starbucks scheme had moved in there. Taraja, the Sulawesi industry at the time, wasn't quite so developed, and so it provided a bit of a comparative between the two. And as you can see there, the red there being the export price, the blue the farmer price. At the export level, it seemed that the coffee coming out of Medan, North Sumatra, was getting a slight premium in the market. They're both sort of heading into specialty markets, I should say. But it seemed to us that the origin, based on our interviews with the exporters, that the slight premium there was due to the fact that it was certified. So it did seem at that level, point of export, there was a premium associated with these schemes. But then we're looking at the farm gate price. Actually, the farmers in Sulawesi were receiving not only a higher percentage of the export price, but a higher price in general. And it seemed, at the time of the survey anyway, going through the supply chain, it was because, largely due to a lot of those costs that I sort of identified in the previous slide. And this is obviously a major concern for advocates of certification schemes and companies that embrace them, that if in fact there's a perverse impact, being that it's generating a downward pressure on the farm gate price, then it's obviously counterproductive to the aims of these schemes. Okay. So just briefly now, what I've been looking into this now, say, for about 7 or 8 years. The next stage that we're going to be doing is trying to quantitatively assess, because whenever I present these findings, certainly to the industry and also to the schemes themselves, they sort of ask for, well, where's the quantitative evidence? So what we're starting now is a program over the next 3 or 4 years to assess at the farm level what the effects of certification have been, based on a before and after introduction, as well as based on a control group versus a target group of farmers. And some of the preliminary results of we did this year, we did a pilot trial of this survey scheme to look at the effects of certification. And in some cases, the responses we were getting were actually quite positive from farmers, that there did seem to be positive practice changes as a result. And there's certainly, if you look at the bottom, in terms of training, a lot more training going on as a result of certification. So that potentially provides a mechanism for knowledge exchange perhaps to take place at the farm level. But this is all preliminary from this year. So in summary, I guess I was trying to make a couple of main points there based on my observations of certification being rolled out in these commodities. The first there is that the fact that these systems have designed or wedded very closely to systems that were designed to address food safety issues, and so therefore the intended benefits of these schemes were in fact the consumers rather than the producers, and that seems to be manifesting itself in the to-date, the rather limited benefits that farmers are getting from participating in the schemes. And say for some producers, like the quote there from South India earlier on, the consumer-led certification initiatives are emblematic of a form of economic and political imperialism. It's very much seen as these people from these NGOs based in Brussels are coming to tell me, a fourth-generation coffee planter who maintains diverse shade on my tree, they're coming to tell me how to manage my farm sustainably. And that sort of is raising a lot of sort of anger amongst some of these communities. The third point there, I guess, is what I've heard referred to as post-sovereign environmental governance. So often the logic behind these interventions or these schemes is that these producing countries can't be trusted to manage the environment themselves. In countries such as Indonesia, there are some pretty serious governance issues, and deforestation is a major problem. So these schemes are often seen as a way of addressing these weaknesses within governance in producing countries. So what we're sort of seeing is what I call extraterritorial environmental management sort of emerging. And one of the problems is how we can re-wed that to these very serious place-based environmental challenges. And then the final point there, which was that there's increasing questions over the ability of certification schemes to make a positive difference in producing countries, and I think the higher transaction costs are part of that. I feel as if I'm quite critical of the way this is being, the way it's being rolled out, all the benefits to date. I should say I do that in the spirit of engagement, and I do sort of work together with a lot of these certification schemes, and a lot of these problems are in fact being increasingly recognised by the companies and by the schemes themselves. So I sort of I see my role as trying to, okay, well, let's look at actually what's happening as a result of this, because I think there are the linkages that can be formed, as we saw with Eric's presentation, between consumers and producers are powerful. And I think that without recognising the role of consumer demand for palm oil, for example, we're never going to get on top of the problem of deforestation in a country like Indonesia. So I certainly see a role there, but I see the way that these schemes have been introduced to date haven't probably had the desired benefits that a lot of us would have hoped they would. So, thank you. Yeah.